So pathophysiology is important in the beginning. The idea was that it is a pneumonia, infective pneumonia, but later, as it appears, and now the understanding is that it is a multi-system inflammatory disease and impacts almost whole body, most importantly lungs. It may impact cardiovascular system, and in general malaise, musculoskeletal pain, headache, lightheadedness. All these, problems can happen. So it is a multi-system inflammatory disease in general, and these pneumonias that patient develop are not infective pneumonia like normal viral pneumonias. These are, inflammatory pneumonia. This is it's a cellular level. There is inflammation, and outcome of that, lung alveoli are not able to filter gases, and the hypoxia happens, oxygen falls dramatically, and this is a very fast phenomena. Then we all already talked about the thromboembolic phenomena, where patients may get this cardiovascular events. And normally, if you look at the age group, the children are the least impacted. You'll hardly hear any serious case or a child death because of the many times. Even the small children, infants, have got positive cases, positive reports, but there are hardly any mortality. And the explanation is that mostly the younger people or the children people, they do not have enough immunity development. Even the older adults, the immunity is well structured. So it is also said that the bad impacts, the ill impacts of COVID is because of the hyperimmune reaction. It's kind of allergic reaction, which may differ person to person. And in the persons who are hyper reactive to this inflammatory infective situation, they are the patients who are developing hypoxia and other complications of COVID. So it is generally seen, and children are relatively safe even if they get infection, but elderly, because they have limited physiological capacity, they have a limitation in coming out of, because once there is inflammatory process or lung inflammation settles, and it is difficult for older people to come out of this assault if they do not get appropriate treatment and supportive treatment at time, because their physiological capacity is limited. Women in general also, we have seen gender-wise that they are better tolerating this situation. This is, I'm also talking practically. Most of the women would have milder symptoms than the males. Few young males have lost their lives because it's a very tricky situation, clinical course. Many times when people get negative reports, they continue to go back to your work if they are in profession where they are required to report back to their office and duty if their exertion is high. So in those patients, many times even the report is negative, but symptoms and fatigue continues. And if they exert their own heart and lungs, their own physiological capacity is not appropriate to a normal level of functioning or working to any occupation. So we have heard stories where policemen, young policemen died. Even many young medical professionals have lost their lives because they posted positive, then negative, then went back to their work. So one of the most important things, gradual occupational graded uptake of going back to jobs and occupation, because physical exhaustion is many times killing patients rather than the actual disease when they had positive report. So rest is very, very important, and this is practically we are seeing that those patients who are not taking rest adequately for appropriate duration of time, they are developing more complications, or they are having more problems. So these are the common symptoms we all know presents undifferentiated fever, cough. Around 30 to 40% patients may have loss of smell and taste. Not all, not everybody will have this typical loss of smell, but a good number of them will have. And it is a spectrum. Many people will present with gastroenteritis. Many people will present with cough, cold, sore throat. Many people will come with high-grade fever. So it depends on the immunity of the person, age of the person, gender of the person, and a patient may present with, you know, so any patient is a suspected patient who is having any of these, you know, symptoms. And many patients will have exhaustion, fatigue. Some will present with pain abdomen, but this is less common. Mostly will come as cough, cold, fever, body ache, headache, tightness in chest, and on later stage, after 5-7 days time, many people may develop breathing discomfort, tightness in chest. Some people will have, you know, lightheadedness, giddiness. Some may complain of some numbness in the limbs or fingers, toes. So these are the common symptoms which I myself also have, you know, noticed among the patients, and we have to be mindful. Earlier, I was not very proactive in testing the patients because testing also required a lot of you know, paperwork, and then, you know, you had to see patients in person, you have to write and stamp, and not all patients could do their test by themselves. But now, over a period of months, things have become easier. So my preference in present practice is that if patients have any of these symptoms, I would definitely prescribe a test, and more often they would come positive. So apart from COVID-19 RT-PCR, which is the gold standard for the testing, there are some questions. I'll take them one by one, but I'll first finish the discussion and then I'll take the questions. And thank you, Dr. Akbar, for your question on Favipiravir and Remdesivir. This is coming on the next slides, so I'll discuss when it comes. But when the patients present with symptoms, it is important also to do their, you know, generally I would first prescribe CBC, complete blood count, and CRP, C-reactive protein, because majority of the patients will have their CRPs because of the inflammatory process. And if they have high risks or some severe disease like high-grade fever or, you know, very violent cough or tightness in chest or difficulty in breathing, I would also prescribe them D-dimer and serum ferritin levels. X-rays, mostly it is possible to know through these blood tests only. X-ray and CT scan is very well practiced in hospital setting, because hospital CT is available, and many times even when patients are negative, it is pneumonia, hypoxia is being practiced. Common blood tests, thank you, Dr. Mili Sinha. You ask about IL-6, which is again, inflammatory marker. So IL-6 is also raised. D-dimer is also raised in the inflammatory condition. So I'll discuss about them. So D-dimer is basically, you know, it defines the cardiovascular risks the patients may have, and especially in the context of, you know, taking decisions for low molecular weight heparin. So I have had patients who had, you know, raised D-dimer and interleukin-6, and those were patients where, you know, not many, but a few, I also prescribed low molecular weight heparin. And as you see, with, you know, anti-inflammatory management over 4, 5, 6 days of period, maximum 7 days, these parameters come down. So it is important to follow CRP, D-dimer, interleukin-6, and serum ferritin. majority of times C reactive protein is high. Few patients, if you do interleukin or D-dimer, but you know the numbers I have seen is less number of patients will have, because few number of patients actually who present in family practice will have severe diseases. So maybe in hospital setting, D-dimer and IL-6 is more appropriate, or you know is more coming on a raised parameter. But in family practice, we see CRP raised often, more often than D-dimer and interleukin 6. So, but these are important parameters which you know you can judge a patient whether they can be kept at home or whether they require higher level of. While we are talking, you know, favipiravir is normally being used. So now it is important to know the course of illness. So there are immediate effects of the infection. There are intermediate effects or symptoms which the patient will present, and there are long-term effects. And now we talk about post-COVID syndrome. So immediate effects are the common symptoms that the patient present: cough, cold, fever, body ache, malaise. Intermediate would be like after 5-7 days, many patients will have some kind of you know, hypoxia, low level of oxygen, fluctuating oxygen. Many times, you know, oxygen would fluctuate between 97 to 94 93, and it is important to monitor these patients very closely. And it is many times in my experience better to monitor these patients at home, because they are family members who care. Even patients who are educated, they can well take care of themselves. Most people would understand and buy a pulse oximeter and check themselves at home. And you know, I'm in my own practice, I am in touch with my patients on WhatsApp and phone, and I advise them appropriately. So if there is problem, I tell them that you call me immediately, and then we can decide on the course of the. Then there are long-term impacts. You know, many patients are now coming. Even today, I had patients where, you know, they suffered or they had problems, positive COVID status in month of October or September. And now they are coming with, you know, fatigue. One of my patients, he is only 32. And even after 2 months of, you know, recovery, becoming negative, he was still complaining that he is having difficulties walking while he is, even do simple day-to-day household works, he was having severe fatigue. So patients are now coming back to us. So we are checking them for, you know, inflammatory markers. Then we are advising them to take adequate rest. Many people are young in working age group, so they are in hurry to go back to your work. Many times in they are under pressure from their, you know, companies and their workplaces to come back to home, and they are COVID negative. So you know, this is a challenging situation, and we must as family physician intervene and advise patients that irrespective of what may come, it is very, very important to take rest. You know, one patient I have advised yesterday only, I have advised 2 months of rest, because patient was still having fatigue, having, you know, mild cough, and you know, so any ongoing problem must be evaluated very diligently, and return to work should be very, very gradual. And if patient require rest, we must give rest in writing that this may be a post-COVID syndrome scenario. There are many symptoms that comes under post-COVID syndrome scenario. So you you know, may like to explore by yourself, and later we can also discuss. But you know, many patients now after 2-3 months, they are coming back with similar problems, and we have read in newspapers. We have also, you know, through our own scientific meetings, we know that many people have severe inflammatory diseases, you know, almost destroyed lung. Even many people have developed cardiomyopathy, you know, and their cardiac muscles have become fibrous. So because of the inflammatory impact, long-term impacts affect, and associated symptoms are coming over a period of 2-3-6 months. So we should be mindful And we must now also ask if somebody comes with, you know, breathing discomfort, tightness in chest, or, you know, fatigue, or, you know, becoming feeling of weakness. You must ask their, you know, previous history. Even if they are not positive COVID, they may have had some, you know, fever-like symptoms in the last 2, 3, 4 months. So it is important to cover and these symptoms from the point of, you know, any potential COVID exposure in past.